This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network. RetroZap.com proudly presents a podcast beyond your experience, beyond your imagination. The DuneCast. With your hosts, Joe Tavano and Rod Johnson, featuring news, analysis, and discussion of everything in Frank Herbert's Dune universe and beyond. Welcome back, friends, to the DuneCast. My name is Joe Tavano, and joining me, as always, my good friend and co-host, Rod Johnson. How you doing, man?
Joe, I'm doing great. Still a great time to be a Dune fan.
This is the best time to be a Dune fan, for sure. And, you know, right off the bat, I want to thank you very much, because you went to C2E2 last month, and you brought me some goodies. That's all I can say. You got me a patch. Fear is the Mind Killer patch with the Muad'Dib Mouse, and I'm drinking out of the mug that you got me, and it has the Atreides Hawk on it, and it is just absolutely unbelievable, and is now my new favorite mug that I drink literally every liquid out of. So I got to thank you so much, brother.
No problem. You've done so much for me, so I was happy to return the favor, and I'm glad you like the mug. The patch was actually not from C2E2. That was an Etsy purchase.
Ooh, look at you. Look at you. Very, very, very savvy finding this stuff. And I got to tell you, a lot of Dune merchandise is out there. A lot of fans making stuff, and a lot of great official stuff coming soon, too. I can't wait to dig into the board game that's going to be released very shortly, as well as new video games and all the other things that are coming out, especially new editions of the novels as well. Very excited about those, too, so can't wait to start collecting those. But we're not here to do any sort of movie update or any sort of merch update. We're here to discuss Chapterhouse Dune. And this is going to be the first episode in our look at this book, the sixth book and the final book by Frank Herbert. And what a book it is. I like it more and more every single time I read it. I feel like the first time a lot of Dune fans read, they speed through 5 and 6 very quickly. And, you know, we say it all the time, these books are worth at least more than one read back to back. And when you do that, you actually start to hear a lot more, and you start to think about a lot more things that are going on in these books. And a deeper inspection of Chapterhouse Dune reveals just so much going on and such a progression that is really, really exciting. So I don't know, I'm really excited to be looking at this book. What about you, Rod?
I'm excited to be talking about any of the books. You talked about reading through 5 and 6, and I think part of it is when you get to Heretics, it's so much more action, especially following God Emperor.
Yeah,
it's such a different style of book that it's easy. God Emperor, you really do have to take your time and read it multiple times, because you're not going to get it all.
No.
And then you get to Heretics and there's action and you just kind of fly through it. And then Chapter House is almost a direct sequel, which is something that's rare in this series.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So I think it just flows right into it.
It does. It does. It flows so well. You can tell Herbert was writing almost instantaneously afterwards. He just kept on writing through it. However, in the books, there is a time difference. There is a number of years have gone by, and I don't think that is made mention of very overtly. To say, you kind of have to piece it together through details that are discussed, and we'll get into it into the book. But it is, I believe, about 8 years at the beginning of the book, and then throughout the book, a few years actually go by. 8 years after Heretics is what happens here. So while it feels like a direct continuation of the book, we're not waking up the next day after Dune was slagged. It's a lot has happened since then, and we're actually picking up in a wartime Bene Gesserit, which is pretty interesting. Did you realize that at first when you think about it, that 8 years had passed since Heretics?
I knew some time had obviously passed, but I, the first time I read it, I wasn't sure how much.
Yeah.
But you know, obviously Shiana's now, she's honored a Bene Gesserit priestess now.
Mm-hmm.
Duncan and Mirabella have had kids.
Yeah, Duncan.
Sytale.
Duncan's an adult.
Is on. Yeah. Sytale is on the ship now. And we have to figure out how he got there.
Yeah, all of a sudden Sytale's back from, you know, remember Dune Messiah. Sytale's back. And we don't know why or how. You learn about that in the telling of the story. And that's, it's really interesting because it feels
what happened to Woff?
Well, Woff died. Woff died in the middle of Heretics, which is funny because Herbert spent so much time developing Woff as a character, only to see him bite it. And I wonder if he regretted that. I wonder if he regretted killing Woff in Heretics, because it seems like as the story developed, he definitely had use of a Tlaloxu master, and he had to kind of bring one back that we all knew. And he seems like Sytale was the perfect candidate for that, right?
Yeah, I mean, the Tlaloxu adds so much to this universe and so much to the stories that I can see where he would be like, you know, I do need to have somebody representing these people.
Yeah,
I like Sytale's a good choice because, like you said, it harkens back to Dune Messiah.
Yeah,
he's been around. He's not just some upstart.
He's someone who knew Muad'Dib, which is a rarity in these times, an exceptional rarity. Think about it. This is a person that would be like saying you knew someone in the Egyptian, the old kingdom in Egypt. I mean, that's wild to think about in that sense. So it's pretty cool. And, you know, he and Duncan are pretty much the only ones who can say that. This book came out in 1985. So this is the only book that came out after the movie, which is also kind of an interesting distinction as well. Because Heretics came out in 84, I believe. In 84, but before the movie. And that's it's an interesting thing to think about. So the movie is not a success at the theaters, and it was widely considered in its time a major box office bomb. So there was a little bit of tarnish with the Dune franchise at that point. Later, it would go on to become a massive massive cult hit and beloved by many people. But there was a little bit of a tarnish on the silver there. So when Chapterhouse comes out, it's almost like a return to form, and it's given fantastic reviews by the New York Times and other book review websites as well, and it was generally well received. Whereas I feel like in decades to come, people would only talk about, you know, Heretics and Chapterhouse being like, yeah, the later books are okay, and not in its day. They were, yeah, these are worthy additions and very, very, very exciting. This is what the New York Times noted. Gerald Jonas of the New York Times noted that against all odds, the universe of Dune keeps getting richer in texture, more challenging in its moral dilemmas. And it's the type of review you don't expect from a sixth book in a series. You don't expect that. You expect to hear about fatigue, and you expect to hear about staleness, and you don't think about it being, you know, even more rich and more interesting. And that's kind of what happened here. And I tend to agree myself. So I don't know.
I think it's not too many books that go, like series that go this long, that have such a different cast in a different time.
That's true.
You know, we've got Duncan.
Yeah.
Duncan and now Sytale. But those are the only two from the original time. And like you were saying, we're 5,000 since the first one.
Yeah.
So it's a it is a whole new universe. It's whole new characters. It's whole new problems. And it's that's just not something you see in series that often.
No, not at all. This was we have to remember that he had planned 7 books. He wanted an original trilogy, a connecting book, which would be God Emperor, and then a second trilogy. So Chapterhouse Dune was supposed to be the dark middle chapter of a second trilogy with all new characters to populate the Dune universe that he had created, with a 7th book being the one that would cap off the entire saga, from start to finish. So it's so tragic, and it's one of, I would say, entire literature's greatest robberies and greatest tragedies, that he was not able to finish it in his time. And we can only speculate on what Herbert would have done with the final book in his trilogy. And almost, it's funny, it's almost comical in its irony that this is the only book he ever did in the Dune universe that had a cliffhanger at the end.
Yeah.
Every single book in Dune ends with a very
could have been the end. Well,
yeah, it could have
Heretics
been
Heretics too.
Heretics has an ending. It does have an ending, and if the series were to end there, it's funny. I feel like he was wrestling with two visions. If he never made another Dune book for most of the Dune books, it would have been fine. You end with Dune, and most people do, and you kind of have a complete story. You end with Dune Messiah, you have a complete story. You have the rise and fall of Muad'Dib. You end with Children of Dune, you have the rise and fall of Muad'Dib, and the eventual ascension of Atreides to a god emperor status, and the complete control of the universe, and the golden path being preserved. You reach God Emperor, and you see the fall of Leto II, and the final downfall of the Atreides' grip on human civilization, and what has become of human civilization after that, and with an understanding that the children of Duncan and Siona will be a safeguard against prescience for all humankind afterwards. Then you get to Heretics, and you see that the control of prescience is far more insidious than we ever thought, and the influence of the Atreides on the universe is far greater than one could have ever imagined. And by the end of the book, that grip has been completely shattered, and there's no way to get it back in any material form. But yet you have a battle that is going on, but you do have some loose threads, but not a cliffhanger. You're kind of left with this idea that Odraid will handle things, and despite the wars and despite the proceedings with the Honored Matres and the Bene Gesserit, that because prescience has been shattered, humanity will go on, and the golden path is no longer linear.
And Spice might not be around.
Yeah,
we do have that as a threat. They've never been able to transplant a worm before. Are they going to be able to do it now?
Yeah. Maybe it'll happen. Maybe it won't. Synthetic spice is now a thing. We don't really even have to worry about worms anymore. There's a lot that's wrapped up by the end of Heretics, where if it were to end, I don't feel like it would be a satisfying conclusion, but it would be a conclusion. However, by the time of Heretics, I do feel like Frank Herbert was setting up a full trilogy, and he did begin to discuss this at the beginning of Heretics, and that's where things start differing. So he gets to Chapterhouse, and he leaves us with a cliffhanger. And it's such a massive cliffhanger, and we're going to get to it later on in our, when we look at the second half of this book. But it's one that will be talked about forevermore. Whenever we look at the Dune series and the Dune universe, it's beautiful in its incompleteness, in a way. It's something that can be studied and analyzed and thought about, because the answer is never given. It's something that completely transforms the past six books. You know, the coda at the end of Chapterhouse completely changes the reading of everything you've read previously, and it just leaves you to speculate and speculate and speculate ad infinitum. And there's something beautiful about that. And more than one person has suspected that it was done on purpose, that perhaps Frank did know he was reaching the end of his life, and there are certain nods, and there are certain things that are discussed in this book that seem to point to the idea that maybe he knew that his own mortality was something he was grappling with, and he would have to come to grips with that. And it might be a little playful nod to the reader, maybe a little bit of a wink to the reader, to tell them that not all things are unfinished, and maybe that's okay. I don't know.
Well, I believe this was written after his wife had passed.
That's true. Bev. Yeah, Beverly.
And there's a really great tribute to her in the back of the book. And so I think that does lead credence to that theory that, you know, he knew it was, his mortality was starting to weigh on him.
It's true.
You know, he's lost his wife, and now he has to wonder, you know, he's not a spring chicken anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. He died. Beverly died February 7th, 84, and he would die February 11th, 86, almost 2 years to the day. Wow. Very tragic. And I don't know. Do you know what he died of? I
believe it was a heart attack, I want to say.
Really? Interesting.
I'm not positive. That's off the top of my head, and it's not something I've looked up recently, but I thought I remember reading a story that he was working on a book at the time.
And no, it was cancer.
It was cancer.
It was cancer.
I thought there was a story about working on a book at the time and some equipment that got brought in. I don't know, paddles or something. Maybe I'm just completely making this up. I don't know.
Perhaps.
But I thought it had done something to a word processor, like a book that he was working on at the time. It wasn't Dune.
I have heard this story that there were files in a word processor that were retrieved right around the time of his death. Yeah, that's true, because it was one of the early digital ones. And at that time, it almost looked like a typewriter, but there would be a chip inside that would store text, like in a text file. So they were not easy to retrieve afterwards, for sure. So yeah, I'm looking at his obituary from February 13th, 1986, from the New York Times. And yeah, he had died of cancer. University of Wisconsin Hospital, 65 years old. And it says, second paragraph here, he had been working with his son Brian on the seventh novel in his Dune series and several other projects at the time of his death, according to Kirby McCauley, Mr. Herbert's literary agent in New York. So yeah, that's right from 86. So interesting. Yeah, absolutely. With a heart attack, no, you wouldn't have seen that coming, but cancer. There may have been a little bit of a coda put on Dune 6 when perhaps he realized that, you know, he may not have known, may not have been able to finish the book on his own, and he might want to have said goodbye in his own way. There might have been a pivot there in the editing process. I don't know.
And we'll never know.
Well, we'll never know 100%. I think that there is some credence to it. I think it's kind of a, there are some winks and nods to many of the it just feels like Chapterhouse Dune very much doesn't feel like a middle chapter. It does feel like an end book in many ways. Many things come full circle in Chapterhouse. The idea of love comes back. The idea of humanity and laughter and many things that we haven't seen since the first book sort of rear their head again. And a final departure from the Atreides hold on prescience is fully explored in Chapterhouse, and the stage is set for new powers to kind of have it out and duke it out, and it's really interesting. So yeah, I don't know. What are your initial thoughts on Chapterhouse in this respect?
I don't know. I can see the argument that he did the wink and the nod, that he didn't think he was going to be able to write book 7, but I honestly feel like he thought he had time to write book 7. I think he did wrap up some things, but I think he left enough open that he expected to finish the story completely.
Yeah,
sadly, we're never going to know exactly, but
yeah,
Brian and Kevin have carried it out, and that's how the story ends.
Yeah, we'll be getting to that. And there are, Brian Herbert and Kevin J. Anderson, completing the Dune saga is now also kind of stuff of myth, seeing as they've been carrying on the Dune universe for quite some time now. And the story of how that happened is also, iconic at this point, by finding the manuscript in a locked vault. But really, Brian was involved right from the beginning on Dune 7. He was working with his father on it. You can tell it right from that obituary. So
he had worked with his father on other projects, Man of Two Worlds.
Yeah, that's true. They wrote together. So, Brian has his own style, and he has, his own way of writing. He's not trying to copy his father, but at the same time, he was very much involved in Dune and wanting to carry on his father's legacy. And really, there's nowhere to steward for Frank Herbert's work and his legacy. And Brian has done an unbelievable job, a humble job, of promoting his father's work in a noble way, much like Christopher Tolkien has, perhaps not as acerbic as Christopher Tolkien can be sometimes, but truly Brian has been a very gregarious and ardent promoter of Frank Herbert and his everything Dune, and we couldn't be more fortunate to have someone like that in his position to bring that forward now. So I give him a lot of credit for sure.
And I've said it before on here that there's a lot of callbacks to the original 6 books that are just minor, and if you read the first 6 and then you read Brian and Kevin's, and then you'll go back and you'll revisit, and then you'll realize they picked this one sentence out of God Emperor.
And told
the whole story about it. And they do that quite a few things. So if you haven't continued on, I do recommend that you can continue on and then go back and revisit the 6 and see how much they really try to honor what was written.
Yeah. And everyone listening to this, I have to say, there are a lot of people who are only reading the first book even now, and they consider the first book to be the end-all be-all of the Dune saga. And if you're listening to this episode, you clearly understand that there is a much bigger story going on there, and the first book really only truly is the setting the stage for the bigger ideas that Frank Herbert wanted to discuss. So, really, I feel like, much like Brian, we have a responsibility to help people understand that there is a lot of amazing material that if they like the first book, they need to keep on going. And they really, it can't be looked at in this with blinders on. It really does. The first book really does need to be taken in the context of the other books. It's not, the sequels are not optional if you ask me. And, you know, we're the diehard fans, of course. But really, once you read them, you really understand that that first book is really just the beginning. And I don't even consider it my favorite Dune book. I really don't. I think it's a great, it's a classic, but not even close to my favorite. I would consider God Emperor probably my favorite. Messiah, my second. Children, I don't know. Children, no, probably Dune, then Chill. I don't know. I'm not getting into the ratings, but
no, mine change. I swear it changes all the time.
It does.
I will say Dune is always going to be my favorite.
The first one, it is
for me.
There is a special place in my heart for it, but you know, I'm just trying to say, let's let people in on how amazing the rest of the books are. And you know, the covers too as well. Yeah, I'm looking at the first edition cover for Chapterhouse Dune, and we finally get a look at what a no-ship should look like. And I was blown away by this. It's just it's an egg. It's a massive, massive egg.
Yeah.
Which is really cool. I love this painting, by the way. The painting of the no ship against the red sky, and
yeah
by John Schoenar, and it's just so cool. And there's I believe there's people in that picture, and that gives it a bit of scope, because it is a massive, massive ship, and it's not.
I mean, it has to be. That sandworm in there.
Yeah, the Great Hold is truly great. Yeah, it's pretty spectacular. Yeah, I loved it. So it's pretty cool. There are other covers to Chapter House that I don't think are as spectacular, but I know the audiobook is just like a picture of fruit. I don't really get it. The audiobook.
Yeah, well, I have the eight.
What's that?
I have the eight books on audio, and I got to be honest with you, the first six, some of the covers, I'm just like, I do not understand this choice.
Yeah, it's like you listen to like 2 seconds of it, and then you.
God Emperor has a wolf. I will never understand why God Emperor has a wolf.
Well, because there was a wolf in like maybe one page of the prologue of the book. That's why.
Yeah, when Siona and her friends are getting chased. But yeah. Other than that, it's.
Chapter House has fruit because Odraid likes to walk in the orchards. You know,
I guess to me that's pretty much a stretch. Not my choice. Not my choice for a cover.
Nope. Not at all. So, what do you say we dive in here and we start talking about some Chapter House Dune? Sound good?
I would love to. I would love to.
All right, let's start at chapter one. So this is 8 years after Heretics of Dune. Dune is gone, of course. It's been obliterated. Miles Teg is gone. The Tel'Axu have brokered a deal with the Honor Matres to give them the technology of the axolotl tanks. However, in the meantime, the Tel'Axu have been wiped out completely,
almost,
except for Cytale, and Cytale is being held captive on a no-ship on the planet Chapterhouse, which doesn't have a name. It is considered temporary by the Bene Gesserit, and even though they've been there for 1,500 years, and Odraid is now Mother, Reverend Mother Superior, and she's taken over from Terraza and has now has complete control over the Bene Gesserit while they're being wiped out by the Honor Matres, who are still on a rampage all these years later because Miles Teg ran real fast and really pissed them off.
He did.
He made them mad. And they actually get into that. They start discussing that sort of rage response later on in the book, but they are
I mean they're wiping out planets,
entire planets. just the show. They're wiping out every single Bene Gesserit planet. And it's not just the
16 so far.
Oh, there were only 16 left.
Oh. No, I thought it was they destroyed 16.
Maybe it starts off they've destroyed 16, but there's even more that get obliterated by the time but as the novel progresses. But they're wiping out planets left and right. And these aren't just planets where the Bene Gesserit are installed and have like bases. This is the Bene Gesserit at this time are essentially a form of civilization and government. They provide structure on these planets to the quote unquote layman and the common folk, and they set up a system of government, a loose confederation, let's call it. Nothing like an imperium, nothing like a guild or anything of that sort, but there is control over these planets, and they're getting wiped out. So we're talking trillions of people, I'm sure. So nothing compared to like what the jihad of Muad'Dib did at that time. I think that was, you know, 6 billion people were killed in the jihad, and that's like a blink of an eye here. And at the same,
they just conquered people. They didn't destroy an entire planet.
Yeah, the planets and planets and planets every day. News is coming into Chapterhouse on what's being wiped out, and the Bene Gesserit are kind of they're going into hiding a little bit. They're on the defensive. They're not really fighting toe to toe with the Onomatres right now, because the Onomatres are just blowing people up.
They're not really fighting battles. Bene Gesserit are used to fighting battles. They're not used to, the ship flies into the atmosphere, use our weapon, destroy the planet, move on.
Exactly. And it's hard to contend with, just blind rage, not wanting to destroy. There's no distinction between destroying people and destroying the planet. It's just complete blind rage and no care for what would be lost by their actions. They just don't care. Because, that's just the Onomatrey way. Any defiance is just met with complete obliteration, because they have no other way to handle it, because their entire civilization is built on complete obedience.
They're definitely not the long-term thinkers that the Bene Gesserit are.
No, that's what they lack. That's their major, major weakness. So Odraide has two counselors. She has Belanda and Tamerlane. And these are great characters. I like Belanda a lot, actually.
She's always annoyed me.
Yeah, she's...
I get that she's a great character, but her personality just annoys me.
She annoys
me. My notes actually call her a curmudgeon.
She is a curmudgeon, and she's not always wrong, though. She's angry, and she, she's very much like a very willful, vocal person. And she's not... she's very frustrated, and she represents the old guard of the Bene Gesserit, and she's aging, and she chooses to be fat. She chooses not to metabolize her body in a way that would keep her fit. She chooses to wear glasses, and let her eyesight fail naturally, as a defiance to, and also an assertion of her seniority within the structure of the Bene Gesserit as well. It's funny, these little things that we think of would be natural aging processes have become such symbols. And then you have Tamerlane, who is just old, I guess is the only way to put it. I think that's really the defining feature of Tamerlane: old and cannot see in a fluid way what to do. She's quickly lined up to be replaced at the beginning of the novel.
She's definitely not fleshed out as much as Belanda's character is.
Yeah, exactly. So the first chapter starts with a new the first Bene Gesserit Gola being born in the axolotl tank. And the first one they choose to grow is Miles Teg. You got excited about Miles Teg. And Miles Teg is back. So they've brought him back as a child. And I think that says a lot, because he died in the last book. We weren't expecting him to come back. And now, Reverend Mothers have volunteered to become axolotl tanks, quote unquote volunteered. And they've produced a new Miles Teg Gola. And, you know, time passes since this chapter, and, you know, we catch up with Miles Teg as a child. And, so at the outset, 16 planets have been destroyed, and more to come there. And, they start asking questions. They start asking questions on what happened to Teg at the end of the novel. No one really knows, because everyone who saw him, you know, died, on Gamu. And they introduce the school of Lampetus in this novel very quickly, the teaching school, which is guarded by Brismali as well, and a huge force of no ships and other other weaponry as well, and shields. And that's kind of where the book begins, and things kind of start happening very quickly after that.
I would like one quick tangent.
Okay.
Do you consider Miles Teg a Gola?
Do I consider him? Without a doubt. He's a clone, I suppose, right?
I always thought, I know they call him a Gola, but I was like, nah, he's a clone. Because the Gola's cadaver cells.
And they took him.
He was alive when those samples were taken.
That is true. That is an interesting. Is there a distinction? Is it a distinction without a difference? You know what I mean?
I always assumed a Gola was from cadaver cells.
Well, yes, that is a true statement. But what is the end product? I mean, whether it is a clone of a person living at a certain time, will there be incomplete memories because you don't have up until the moment of death? Is that the distinction?
Well, I mean, it was the problem they ran into when they tried to awaken him.
That's true.
They didn't have the pain. They didn't have the pain from
that
moment of death.
That is true.
We'll get there.
We'll get there. We don't get there in this episode, though. No, it does happen, though. We'll have to talk about that. But so that's very interesting. But yeah, for the first part of this book, he is treated as a Gola, and it's interesting to see how Bene Gesserit treat a Gola when they understand what they have created, because they're very upfront with him. They're like, you are a Gola, and you will be awakened for a very specific purpose, and we want you to know who you are. And it's a completely different way of looking at the technology and the purpose of Gola.
It's much, much different than what they did with Duncan.
Yeah.
You know, where Duncan, they tried to hide information, and, you know, people were punished if he got too much information about what a Gola was and who he was.
That's true.
They're just kind of, we want you to learn everything you can.
Yeah. I mean, you have to remember too, Duncan was commissioned by the Tlaloxu, so he is an outside product, a third party product, let's say. And there's still a lot of questions about, you know, what Duncan actually is. Are there even more secrets to Duncan than we know? And Duncan is quite an enigma in this book, and he becomes the central enigma of the entire Dune series at this point. Because we must remember, at the end of Heretics, he had been able to sexually bond Mirbella in the same way Honor Matres do, which was a hidden talent, and that awoken all of the memories of every Duncan Idaho Gola between the first one and him. And it didn't matter that he didn't have all the cells, which is something quite interesting. How do you retain the consciousness and the memory of every Gola if you don't have all the cells? It's an interesting conundrum. And it kind of puts Duncan in a very interesting place with having, quite advanced mentat abilities to be able to project, to a degree where he can almost see the future in the same way Muad'Dib could. Yet he could at the same time remember everything in the past, just like Leto could. I wouldn't say Leto. I would say probably closer to Paul, because he remember his own memory and his own, his own lives, not other memory going back, stretching back to the dawn of civilization. He can't do that. But the Bene Gesserit fear that he is another form of a Kwisatz Haderach, which is kind of an interesting question. We have to examine, and we'll get to that a little bit later. But I don't know. I think it goes back to this idea of tangential powers all kind of converging in the same way. And we discussed that before. And it kind of just seems like Duncan is just this other type of Kwisatz Haderach that could be emerging as a result of the refinement of human ability. And I don't know. How did you reconcile that yourself?
I thought it was more, I always interpreted it that the Bene Tleilax, the Tleilaxu were trying to figure out a way. They obviously wanted to Kwisatz Haderach, and how do you get the DNA memory? Because they don't have the power to do it like the Bene Gesserit do, the Spice Agony.
Yeah.
So in order to get that long-term thinking, long-term planning, you do it through ancestral memory. That was just kind of their workaround.
Well, true. It's true. But how does he tap into golem memory that he isn't getting from dead cells? There are gaps. How does he do that? He's outside of time. There is something almost mystical about the way he can remember that. What did they do to him to have that happen? You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's a good question, and I'm not really sure.
I think that's where the super being part of this comes into play, and there's something there has to be some sort of prescience there that is taking hold. There has to be some sort of additional ability that has been imbued into Duncan to have this work. And it's a mystery that gets kind of not really solved, not really discussed. We might pick it up a little bit more in the later books. But so that's kind of where we are. So Duncan's abilities have been awoken, and he is now teaching other men to bond Andromatres out in the universe as kind of an insurgency against the Andromatres. And he is addicted to Mirbella, and Mirbella is addicted to him in the same way. It's an interesting dynamic, because they are bonded to one another, and there's a certain parity and equality there, but at the same time, they're also very much in love with each other, and they would rather not have the addiction part of it overshadow their love. And it's very interesting to have them debate and discuss that. And we get that later chapters. The book opens with this sort of, it kind of dumps us right into the story there. And we get an interesting kind of look at how Chapterhouse operates and the bureaucracy of Chapterhouse. And, I'm sure the Bene Gesserit would tell you there is no bureaucracy there, but there is. There's a certain structure, and we learn a lot about the workings of how this planet works and how the larger scope of how the Bene Gesserit order operates. And it's very insightful.
Like, we get a lot more background, whereas in the first four books, we almost think like the Bene Gesserit, they all just comply. Whoever's in charge, they make decisions based on what's good for the organization. And in Heretics and Chapterhouse, we start finding out that no, they do fight amongst themselves. They don't always agree on what should be done. And
yeah,
but we almost think like Jessica's the one that she branched off and did her own thing, and that was so uncommon. And we're finding out more and more that it's not that uncommon. That you know, maybe Darwin does lead the Bene Gesserit, but it's not unanimously. There are people that are not happy with the direction. There are people that think maybe they could go another direction. And we find out that they vote on leaders, which is kind of weird that they vote. She kind of gets placed because, you know, she has the Tar inside, you know.
Yeah,
she took Tar's memories, and so she's in charge, but then they have a vote to maybe replace her, which was kind of weird.
So Terraza died at the end of Heretex, and she becomes Reverend Mother essentially because she is the only one with whom Terraza shared her memory. So she embodies Terraza as well as Odraid, and that is valuable to the Bene Gesserit, and that's valuable for leadership. Therefore, she becomes Reverend Mother on that credibility. However, Odraid is not
Odraid.
She's Odraid. She's Atreides, and she's also, you know, a very unique and wild Bene Gesserit, not someone everyone can believe in. And you see that through Belanda, who I don't think would have voted for Odraid, and Tamerlane as well, who are much more traditional Bene Gesserits. But it might be, Odraid's heretical nature, so to speak, might be the thing that actually saves them the most, because she can see differently. She can think differently than a normal Bene Gesserit. And it all goes back to this idea of that was started in Heretics, of her being adopted into the full order much later than usual acolytes, because she was hidden because of her Atreides blood, and almost like a like royalty in hiding almost, and until her parents were not her birth parents, but her hiding parents were killed, and then she was brought in, and she learned the ability to love, and she saw the world in a much different way. And you have this whole interplay of a sea child, which is her her free and unique persona, I guess, within herself, the child, the inner child, in her psyche, that she's able to kind of tap into to see things in a different way, which is an interesting construct in this book, right?
Yeah. I it did catch me off guard the first time when I read it. I actually had to reread that part, the sea child.
Yeah, me too.
To realize what exactly Frank was going for there.
I didn't dig it at first. I was like, what are we talking about here? Water? Like, what's up? But the second time I read it, I'm like, oh, I get it. It's a meditative. It's almost like a mantra. It's a meditative state that she's able to project herself into to start tapping into different areas of her personality and her consciousness to see things differently. And I like that a lot. At the same time, she also has something else in her mind, and that's the Spider Queen. And, with the Bene Gesserit, with the Onomatries obliterating planets, she's literally just having to write off planets. Like, oh, we can't defend them. 6 billion down, 12 billion there. Like, this whole first chapter is her just writing off planets as well, doing paperwork around it.
And what it does to her psychologically.
Yeah.
To just have to just say, like you said, that's 6 billion I can't save. They're done.
Yeah, indefensible. And, the weight of that being done through paperwork crystal work, yes, Redulian crystal work. But it's pretty heavy stuff and very, very dark. In the back of her mind is the great honored Matre, who she doesn't know, she's never seen, she's never met, and she considers her the Spider Queen at the center of a web of honored Matre servitude. And it's an interesting image of this woman. And we, in chapter two, we learn much more about the honored Matres, and we learn more about great honored Matre herself, Dama, who is she's old, she's sinewy. And unremarkable features are literally what is how she's best described. She looks like a very ordinary woman for this conquering marauder. I'm not sure what to make of that, but I don't know. I kind of expect she'd look kind of like a sitcom mom almost. You know what I mean? Like, just like, you know, someone who's trying to look ordinary, or just ordinary features, not like this Amazon woman or a supermodel or something, you know, you could actually pinpoint, just a very expressionless features. With a weak chin, I guess we find out later on too.
Yeah. Hit the chin.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we'll get that. Yeah. And the second chapter is literally just kind of painting the picture of who Great Onomatre is. She sits on her throne, orange flecks in her eyes.
We forgot to cover one quick thing in chapter one.
Sure.
Is that Darwi's realizing they can't just sit back anymore, you know, as they're riding off these planets and these indefensible. You can't just hang out at Chapter House and hope for the best. At some point, you have to take action. And that's why they brought Miles back, is they've got to figure out a way to kind of take the fight to the Honored Matres.
Yes, I think that's a very important point. I think it was a little bit underplayed in Chapter 1, what's actually going on. But yeah, the fight, that is the kind of the big thrust of the book. They need to figure out how to fight back. What's the best way to teach them a lesson that they'll never forget, I think is really the ultimate Bene Gesserit point. Not just win the battle, but teach them a lesson that they will remember in their genes, so to speak. But back to two, we see that Great Onomatre has taken a captive Bene Gesserit. She seems to do this plenty. She's on her throne on the planet Junction. Interesting planet names. Central, Junction. Very, very standard utilitarian names. Chapterhouse. Very interesting. And then you have planets like Lampadas and Gamu and these very flowery names as well. So you can tell the difference between when they were kind of founded, I think. I think the more recent planets seem to have very, very functional names. I don't know. It's not something really discussed much, but it's kind of something I just thought about, reading into it. Also, we have Futars. Futars were they even mentioned in Heretics? I'm not even sure. They were very minimally.
Yeah, minimally.
Yeah.
But I believe they were mentioned, yes.
Yeah. Cat-human hybrids. With
sounds awful.
Yeah, it does. All I was thinking is Thundercats the entire time. actually, you know what I really think? I think more like the island of Dr. Moreau. That's yep. What always comes to mind. You know, these kind of horrible, disgusting, mutated things with limited intelligence, and that's kind of what they are. And they're feral, and they can't be that disgusting because the Honor Matres use them for sexual pleasure once they've bonded them. But they, Futars are a mystery in this book. Actually, there's one cover of a Chapterhouse Dune cover that actually shows a Futar, and they're kind of like little gray things. I don't know, not how I would picture them, but kind of weird, almost like goblins, you know? So they have limited speech and they like to eat people. But yeah, the odd thing about it is because the first time we see a Futar, they're in captivity by the Honor Matres, but they were supposed to be, the legend has it that they were bred to kill Honor Matres. So there's a discrepancy there that needs to be explored. And the Bene Gesserit don't really get it. And we see that from their eyes.
And they're also, the Futars are always asking for the handlers.
That's true.
Where handler?
Where's the handlers? Who are the handlers? Where are the handlers? So they need to figure out what that is. And we find out a little more later. Chapter three, we start talking to Miles Teg as a boy. So a few years have passed since chapter one, at least, or it was a flashback within chapter one. And you know, we start to see how he's being trained, like we were discussing before. And we start talking about the desert on Chapterhouse. They have brought the sandworm from Heretics back to Chapterhouse, and they're starting to transform it into a new dune. Or at least that's the plan. And this becomes a central feature of at least the first half of the book. Odraid is intent on creating a new dune, preserving the sandworms. Not sure why. To be perfectly honest, why are they doing this? Why is it so important to have sandworms?
Like you said, they don't need the spice.
Yeah.
Because they can... Well, they can't do it yet. I think the Tleilaxu, like Saitel, is holding out the seek. He's held that back. But
they know it's only a matter of time.
If they show him, you know... Yeah. And if they're able to bring the sandworm back and they bring it to Saitel, then it scores them two victories. A, we don't need you for your synthetic spice.
True. True.
B, here's your profit.
Yeah.
We control your profit.
That is true as well.
It also brings back Shiana into the Machinaria Protectiva, because if she can still control these worms.
Yeah.
Which is something that in the previous chapter
remains to be seen.
The Bene Gesserit that was killed kind of hints to the Spider Queen, you know, hey, Shiana might still be alive.
It's true. She might be alive. You know, and, you know, what will happen with the worms? No one really knows. Like, will the pearls of awareness still exist within the new worm? Will they be able to be controlled by Shiana? Will prescience once again control the, you know, the universe? Or has that gap now been, you know, the gap in years when it didn't control it? Was that enough of a gap to allow wildness to return to the future? And they feel like it is. They feel like there would never be a way to control it again. But, you know, a lot of unknowns as well. So a little bit of let's see what happens experimentation going on with the worms. But no one's seen a worm yet. They see evidence, but no one has seen a worm yet. And there's a lot to anticipate there, saying, well, will it happen? Will we actually see one? What's happening down, you know, by the equator of Chapterhouse? There's some interesting conversation in chapter two on symbiosis and how the land and the people, and a return to this ecological discussion that began in the first book. And one that kind of had been put aside for the past couple of books as well. And I think that, you know, this is one good instance of Frank kind of coming full circle and his discussions about, you know, what the themes of Dune and, you know, a symbiosis with people mark the land and the land marks people. And, that's something stated, you know, back from the Fremen down till now. And, you know, how the Bene Gesserit cultivate humanity as a garden is a very interesting way of looking at the purpose of the Bene Gesserit, and also the symbology of gardens on Chapterhouse as well. I love this line by Odraid: "We are interested in everything that grows," and also there are some weapons that can be only held in the mind, and I feel like that's a perfect way to describe the entire series. you know, Dune is very much an exploration of weapons that can only be held in the mind and not in the hands. And I feel like that gets forgotten a lot, especially in the first book.
So many good lines in the books, but
yeah, definitely. Okay, chapter four. We're back with Greyhound and Matre. We're going back and forth, kind of bouncing back and forth here between perspectives. Something you didn't see, like, you never really saw a ton of, you know, the bad guys, so to speak, in the, in previous books, kind of going, bouncing back and forth. So we're finally,
there'd be a chapter every once in a while, but that was about it.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is a great chapter where we start really learning a little bit more about the background of the Honor Matres and their society and where they're coming from. So they, you know, in her mind, she talks about the disasters of the scattering and the enemy of many faces. The enemy of many faces. I mean, what are we talking about here? Are we talking about face dancers? All signs seem to point to yes, that the Automatres have a new... It's been hinted the Automatres were running. They weren't invading the old Imperium. They were running
they
from...
They were fleeing back.
Yeah. Yeah, they were fleeing an old a new enemy. And it's the enemy of many faces, and it's heavily suggested that these are a different kind of face dancer that was... that rose to prominence out somewhere in the scattering. And then we're introduced to the character of Lanyo, who is Great Automatre's assistant, I guess you'd say, second in command.
Yeah.
And number one, the Riker to the Picard of Great Automatre. I don't know.
I'm gonna be honest with you, Star Trek references are gonna be lost on me.
Yeah, that's as far as I go. I'll tell you that right now. Going to my notes right here. When they talk about how on Automatre's succession and leadership, it's like you're killed, you know, and someone else asserts their dominance and takes your place because they killed you. It sounds a lot like the rule of two in Star Wars, like that. It sounds more like the Sith than anything else, which is interesting. Yeah.
I mean, it's one of those, if you're not strong enough to lead anymore, somebody's going to kill you and take over.
Yeah.
And that's what Lanyo wants to do.
Yeah, exactly. Hopefully she'd one day take her place. So she's biding her time, but also at the same time, completely obedient. The first mention of a super weapon as well. They have a weapon that would... I don't know, like... They're already killing planets. Why do they need another weapon? What insanity is this? It's pure destruction at short range. It's just a black tube, but they don't have a charge for it. They need the charge. And, I don't know.
I wonder if this is something Frank was going to come back to.
Yeah, they never really got to it. It's not really talked about again in the book, right?
No.
No,
I mean they're trying to get the Twi'leks the Bene Twi'leks.
Yeah,
they're trying to get it.
I think they need Ix. That's it, right?
It was the Ixians. Yeah, they were trying to get the Ixians to recharge it. And the Ixians are like, we don't know what this is.
So is this the real reason they're coming back to the old Imperium to try and get a charge for the super weapon to go back to the fight? Is that really what we're doing here? Maybe. It seems like one of the reasons, at least.
Yeah. I mean, it could have been. One of those we'll never know.
Yeah, we're never really... It's never really explored.
It's one of those you almost... You wonder if he wasn't setting this up, like Book 7 was going to be part of this weapon originally.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the applications for one.
Yeah. And then, you know, we get a line here. The ones of many faces caused the disaster. Them and their futars. Like, so it heavily sounds like the face dancers bred futars and they caused a massive disaster within the Automatre society. And they did something horrible. We can only speculate. And inside her head, she's not explaining anything, which is something that Frank does a lot. Then she starts thinking of the planet Boozle, with its Sue stones, and they wonder if it's a trap, you know?
Yeah.
It just
seems like, why would you just leave it unprotected? But
yeah,
honestly, there wasn't a whole lot they could do at this point.
Yeah, there just wasn't a part. So they're almost giving the Bene Gesserit too much credit at that point. But Odrade will catch up pretty quickly. All right, chapter 5. This is where we start getting into, water sea child and these water images. And, it's interesting. It's almost like it's almost like a path to prescience when we start thinking about the sea child, because she's able to like tap into her, you know, wild Atreides abilities a little bit. You know what I mean? It's a talent.
Yeah, she kind of uses it. She can see the danger, but, you know, she doesn't have like the full prescience. It's just a mild hint of it.
Yeah, and it's funny because it only seems to be tuned towards dangers for the Bene Gesserit. If the actual sisterhood is in danger, it's something that she seems to be able to predict really well by tapping into the sea child mode. You know, interesting. The ability to balance on strange seas is a another great line from this chapter. I feel like Herbert's very poetic when it comes to Adraid. And he really
definitely enjoyed writing her.
Yeah.
I think every book you can kind of tell the characters he really enjoys writing.
Yeah. He liked I think he liked Terraza, he likes Adraid, he likes Teg quite a bit.
Well, how do you not like Teg, to be honest?
Yeah, Teg is an awesome character. I really hope we get a Heretics movie, because I want to see a Miles Teg being cast. You know?
And then a 10-year-old Miles Teg riding around on the shoulders.
Yeah, it'd be pretty cool. Definitely. So interesting. She starts to think about Miles Teg and the fact that, you know, it's rumored that he was able to detect node ships before he died and other shielding technology. And it's really interesting. It's a very destabilizing force in, you know, it could be a very destabilizing force in the future civilization of the Dune universe. It's almost like an order of magnitude of prescience higher than we've seen before. Like, you have this escalation of prescience. You have prescience in Paul and then like super prescience in Leto, going backwards and forwards to infinity, essentially. And then you have, like the anti-prescience with Siona and then no ships. And there seems to be a balance there at some point where prescience is nullified by the ability of no ships. And then you have, and then all of a sudden Teg, you know, takes it a step further. Now you can see the no ships and, you know, everything is laid out before him with this super speed, but he's not really predicting the future. He's almost moving through it. You know what I mean? Like it's really interesting how he could almost like play with time at the same time. And I find that to be very, very interesting. How Herbert was kind of transposing these ideas from the metaphysical to the actual physical. At this point, you find out a little bit more about Sytale, Marbella, Duncan Idaho, three prisoners on a hidden no-ship that is on Chapterhouse right now. And you don't get much more about that, but we learn quite a bit more about this hidden no-ship later on. And, you know, Odraid's train of thought is completely thrown aside as Belondo walks in and just screams, Lapidus! And Lapidus, the great teaching school of the Bene Gesserit. And I always think back to that one painting at the beginning of some of the film introductions, of Bene Gesserit teaching people at the beginning of the Lynch movie. And are you drinking some spice ale there?
I wish. I'm all out of spice ale, just plain old water.
There you go. And Lampetus has been destroyed and there's no survivors. Burzmali, the cool Bashar from Heretics, is gone, and Lucilla is believed to be dead. And and they seek to verify it, and this is it. They mention that a rabbi has confirmed it, and they this is it's the first mention of Jews in the Dune universe, which is completely threw me for a loop the first time I heard that. It's just a casual.
Oh, yeah, 100%. I was like, wait, what?
Yeah, casual mention of his rabbis all of a sudden being Chom spies for the Bene Gesserit. And you're like, what? Wait, what? And I love that it's just like a casual reference and you don't even hear about it for another few chapters.
Yeah, like, is this a different rabbi? Is this term used differently?
Mm-hmm.
You know, 15,000 years from now?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
No, it is not.
So this is a massive tragedy here. You know, so much knowledge. It's almost like the Library of Alexandria being destroyed in ancient times, but you know, to a massive, massive more degree, because all of that other memory, all of that scholarship, all of the potential of the Bene Gesserit is all there, and it's all gone, along with their with a massive amount of their military force. So it's all gone. And then you cut to chapter 6. Well, before that, you find out Odraid has decided that Tamerlane will be replaced on her high council by Shiana. Tam's too removed and too set off from the everyday workings of the Bene Gesserit. And Shiana is young. She is, like Odraid, very different from the average Bene Gesserit. And she's also becoming a religious figure in her own right. So there's plenty for her to add, I think, to Odraid's perspective. And Tamerlane seems just more of the past and more of the same, if you ask me.
Yeah. And at this point, she Darwe obviously values outside the box thinking, to use the dumb cliche.
Yeah, she kind of needs
this. This is a problem the Bene Gesserit haven't been in, the situation they've never really been in.
Yeah,
you know, even when they were being suppressed by the God Emperor, they weren't being attacked,
and they weren't being wiped out. They were being made to heal. They were made to be subservient. You know, Leto positioned himself as the leader of the Bene Gesserit, in a lot of ways. So they schemed and conspired, but Leto never wanted to wipe out the Bene Gesserit at all.
No, this is the first time they've really ever faced extinction in their history.
Yeah. And
in the old guard, you know, they need somebody that, you know, isn't going to be thinking along the same lines, you know, is not set in their ways.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is interesting that any Reverend Mother, you know, has that ability with other memory to not be set in their ways to some degree.
Exactly. I mean, this is the same. And, you know, in almost the same breath, Herbert is telling us that they don't have historians or history books because they don't need them, because each one of them is a living embodiment of that knowledge. And there's a danger in that, because when you die, it's all lost. Yeah. And you cut to chapter 6.
When your planet gets blown up.
Yeah. That's a big loss right there. Probably, you know, a flaw of the whole system. You get to chapter 6 and you have Lucilla, who is, we find out, carrying the hoard of Lampadas. Everyone shared with one another, and all of those memories, all of those lives and people are all shared within Lucilla at this point. She has a massive, massive amount of other memory, and she's a repository for it. It's kind of amazing she didn't go insane. Much like Alia did, but she was trying to escape, and she was shot down by an Onomatre trying to escape in an O-ship, and she's hiding in on Gamu, being treated by a Jewish Souk doctor. And we find out that in this chapter, oddly enough, the one group to kind of make it through all of the ages, through, you know, our centuries, you know, our modern history, off of you know, Terra, off of Earth, through the future into the Butlerian Jihad, past the Butlerian Jihad, past the Imperium, past the Battle of Corin and the Carino Empire, past the Atreides Empire, past Leto II, the Tyrant, and all the way, how many tens of thousands of years later, we can only guess, the Jewish race and religion has completely survived as a secret Israel, and they a great deal of time is spent being discussed on how they have hidden in plain sight and hidden in complete secrecy to an extent to which no other group has ever known.
It's impressive to think the secrecy that would have been entailed for this many millennia to be able to live in secret that long and still have your culture and your history.
And all other cultures seem to have been amalgamated. You know, they have the Orange Catholic Bible, you have Zen Sunni and Zen Sufi, and everywhere else, Herbert has blended and advanced cultures. So they're nothing like what we know in today's history and current history. So to have something set apart and a direct connection is really very interesting. And this secret alliance between the Bene Gesserit and secret Israel goes back to the Battle of Corin, actually, when they were being wiped out. And only a few within the Bene Gesserit actually understand about this alliance, and the secret dies with them, and it is a deep, deep honor between both groups as they're considered it. It's a very, very interesting development, and you gotta wonder why Herbert decided to make this move. It's a very interesting one to think about. You know, what is the one group? I guess it's probably like the one group he really hasn't discussed at this point. It's kind of holding his back pocket, I guess, right?
Yeah, I'm trying to think if there's another group. Well, I mean,
all the great religions of Earth have been discussed in some way.
Yeah,
but you don't have he never discussed Judaism until now, and it's pretty interesting.
And it's not only a religion, it's a culture.
Yeah, it's true. It's true.
It's almost an ethnicity.
It's an ethnicity and completely. So in any event, Lucilla has called upon a rabbi to help her hide because she's stuck on Gamu, and this ultra secret alliance is being invoked right now. A guild navigator is actually actively searching for her on Gamu, which is interesting because we haven't really heard about guild navigators in a while. It's one of the Edrics, they call them. So Edrics are either being cloned or created, but another reference to Dune Messiah. So you have Cytale, and now you have Edric back. So I wonder if they're like guild navigators.
I was assumed it was a descendant somehow, but I don't know.
One of
guild
the Edrics.
Navigators procreated.
I'm assuming it might have been a Gola, a guild navigator Gola.
Huh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
One of the Edrics is all we find out.
I never really thought about that.
Yeah. And we also find out that the Jews have Siona blood now to help them hide themselves. They make adjustments as needed, is what they say throughout the history. So the rabbi gets questioned by the Edric, but suspects that he is hiding something, but doesn't know. It's kind of sad how far the guild navigators have fallen in the ranks of society, because they were at one time almost like secondary prescient beings. They were under Muad'Dib almost to contend with him and his power. And now they're just kind of like hounds to sift out people as they can. And they're working for the Andromatres. Like the entire guild is kind of at the disposal of the Andromatres in a way. It's kind of sad if you ask me.
Yeah. I mean, they were once such a powerful organization.
Yeah. The decline of Chome and the Space Guild. Interesting. It's funny. There's some other weird, I don't know if it's weird parts of this, but I think that a lot of times the connection between the Jewish culture and our culture is a direct connection between the future and the present that Herbert can use to kind of talk about things that was going on in his time too, modern issues. And I swear there is a passage when the rabbi starts talking about narcotics and stopping them on the borders, that he's talking, you know, this is Herbert talking about the war on drugs that was, you know, raging in the 1980s. I don't know.
Did Nancy Reagan is in full force on this.
Yeah. It just seems very interesting how he talks about the failure of being able to stop narcotics on the borders that way. It completely sounds like a commentary. Yeah. In any event, there's no way to get Lucilla off Gamow alive. And
writing off planets, writing off Bene Gesserit.
Yeah.
People are just getting written off here, right and left.
Yeah, exactly. So the rabbi realizes this. The hounds are out. There's no way to sneak her off. Every way will be watched. So it's revealed that Secret Israel in this time has their own form of Bene Gesserit in other memory. And they don't undertake the spice agony. Oh, no, they do. They do undertake the spice agony.
Yeah. Rebecca had undertaken the spice agony.
Yeah.
And the rabbi wasn't too crazy about it. He's like, you can see she's done a foolish thing.
That's true. So I guess,
by the way, the rabbi is like one of my least favorite characters.
Well, how come? Series. Is it because he's conservative in a way? Like
constantly judging and just... I didn't like how he down talked Rebecca the whole time. And
yeah,
he just feels like his way is the right way. Anything else is wrong, which we all have an extent of that. But he is so closed minded.
Yes, there. You know, keeping a culture secret tends to lead to a lot of isolationism, and I think that the rabbi is a symbol of that, and it's a mirror for what the Bene Gesserit stand to become. Because at this point, the only way to survive is to either destroy the Ordo Mater or become a secret society. And like the Jews had become after the Battle of Corin. And I think that that's what we're playing off of here. We're playing off of the rabbi and Belanda being very similar characters in wanting to stick to tradition and wanting to... follow the prescribed path that has been, you know, set out before them. And they understand certain rights and certain wrongs, and they try to see things very much in black and white. And, it's interesting. It seems like, so have Jewish women been able to share other memory among themselves for years? Is that what happens here? Or is Rebecca kind of the first to do this?
I don't know if she's the first, but I get the impression that it is something not done. Like, it's not something that, like, the Fremen used to have. You know, the Fremen used to have wild honored or Bene Gesserit.
True.
Or
Sayyidinas.
Yeah. And I feel like the Jewish, you know, they don't really have that. You know, the rabbi mentioning that she has done a foolish thing makes me think it's not something that's done very often, and not being done under command, I don't think he wanted her to do it.
Yeah, maybe,
but
there's
she
a,
did it.
I got the impression that the Secret Israel had they had their own form of it, much like the Fremen did, but it didn't involve sharing with, you know, an outside group and understanding that sort of part. So I feel like the sharing was the part that the rabbi objected to the most for. Because the
relationship very much changed between the two of them after she shared.
Yeah, it would break the line. It would break the lineage and the purity of Rebecca's memory in that way. Because it would not just be the memory of the Jewish race at that point. It would be all the wisdom of the Bene Gesserit as well. And by carrying that, they feel they make a sacrifice, and that's completely understood.
And I might be wrong here, and if I am, I apologize. I feel like I'm stepping out on a limb here, but I believe isn't the Jewish heritage, isn't that considered on the maternal line?
Yes, that's 100% true. And that's made mention in the book, too. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
it's
almost worse in the rabbi's eyes because the memories, outside memories, are getting shared.
Yes.
Through the female line.
Exactly. And that's kind of where the other memory kind of makes sense. It's an extension of that tradition in the Jewish culture and faith. So it's very interesting, how it all sorts of fits in there. And yeah, unfortunately, because to get the horde of Lampetus off of Gamu, he's going to have to sell Lucilla out, to keep them hidden and to get the horde off. But, that's what he's done.
Not only are we going to write you off, we're going to essentially hand you over.
Yeah. But you know, this is about higher motives here, you know, higher powers and, bigger pictures than,
and this is generally what the Bene Gesserit are okay with.
Yeah. I mean, that's true.
They would have done it too. In the first chapter, what was it? The second chapter or the third chapter with the Spider Queen.
Yep.
The priestess knew she was going to die. You know, she's just like, man, I'm going to die. So I'm going to do what I can to advance mm-hmm. for the sisterhood. You know, I'm going to plant some uncertainties in her head and,
we'll see what we can do.
We'll see where it goes.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Next chapter, chapter 7, we meet up with Shiana, who seemed to be positioned as a very, integral character in Heretics, but now maybe more of a secondary. And, she's, sculpting Plaz at this time, an artist, and she's watching for worms by the desert's edge. She kind of has her own little thing set up here by the desert's edge, in the years since Heretics of Dune. She's waiting essentially to become a new messiah if the worms reappear. And it's interesting. And this is where
it's so weird what's happened with her. You know, she went from this child, and when she was being raised in Arrakis, had everything that she wanted, and then she decides, you know, I want to be a Bene Gesserit, and she becomes a Bene Gesserit. She goes through the spice agony, supposedly the youngest ever, and then she's just kind of at a loss, like, what do I do now?
Yeah.
She's very conflicted, very angsty.
The worms are gone too, so she's like, who am I now as well?
Yeah, right? And so, yeah, she's a very different Shiana than we had in the last book.
Yeah, and she wants to...
She's acting out a lot.
Yeah, we get this idea that she feels a little pinned in. She wants to create her own life. She feels like she's been kind of controlled her entire life. People have always have forced her to be something that she didn't necessarily choose. And, you know, that's very much doubled up with Duncan and Mirbella as well, who are also kind of pinned in with their... They want to be able to choose love, not be forced into it. And, yeah, it's a very similar sort of conflict that they have to resolve. And, it's interesting. And a lot of what we've talked about here is part of, you know, we explained a lot of what happens here. So it was an interesting check-in on Shiana, and we'll get back to her later on in the novel. Chapter 8, Belanda, Odraid, and Tamerlane watch Mirbella and Duncan through the calm eyes. And this is a storytelling construct we see a lot moving forward in the book. The calm eyes are essentially, you know, cameras, and they have people watching them at all times in this no ship. And you have kind of two sets of conversations going on. You have the conversation of them being watched, and you have the conversation of what the people being watched are trying to say, and then what they're saying publicly as well. And there's just a lot of musings right now. Belanda is organizing a second Bene Gesserit scattering, each of them taking a little bit of sand trout with them as well to try and populate out of the world, just in case Chapter House is found and destroyed, and just in case the entire Bene Gesserit is obliterated. Even though no Bene Gesserit ever returned from the scattering, they're doing it again. It's the Hail Mary pass, right?
Yeah, it's kind of the why not. I mean, you want to hedge your bets, and this is essentially what they're doing, like you were saying.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they can get the sandworms back on Chapter House. Maybe they can't. but you know, why not try more than one planet?
Yeah. So they're sending,
because you know they're relying a lot on Shiana. If they are able to bring back these sandworms, Shiana suddenly becomes this holy figure in their religion.
Well, you know, they're sending people out there with these sandworms.
Air quotes around religion.
But they have no idea where these people are going either. They're just sending them off into space. So this is a fracturing of the Bene Gesserit forevermore. I think that the original scattering, people were supposed to return and they never did. They were supposed to make contact and expand the Bene Gesserit influence. In this case, they're sending people off being like, go, figure it out, survive, you know, make sure the Bene Gesserit live on. So this is a fracturing, a loss of communication. And, you know, hopefully the worms will exist again. Hopefully the Bene Gesserit will exist still. And Belanda wonders, will we ever be whole again? And the answer is no, never again. And, you know, they still wonder what the hell happened to the rest of the Bene Gesserit in the first scattering. What happened to them? There's never a definitive answer.
Then there's the theories of, did the honored Matres come from Bene Gesserit that went out into the scattering? They're not sure yet.
They're not sure. We get a little bit better of an answer later in the book, right?
Yeah, but at this point, we don't know.
No, we don't. We don't. Yeah. We find out that Mirbella and Idaho have had three children so far, and they've all been removed at birth because they need to be watched to see if they have any wild talent, and it's too soon to tell. Yeah, interesting. There's some idea of the sex addiction techniques of the Honored Matres are being learned from Mirbella, and yeah, like Shiana's practicing some of them as a little bit of a heretic, and others are as well. So that sort of knowledge is getting out there. Yeah. There's some ideas of Cytel withheld information about some of the axolotl tanks. Some question there about, well, you know.
I mean, you're foolish if you trust him completely.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And obviously Audrey doesn't.
Yeah. And then the question of what did the Telaxel do to Duncan Sells? Not all of them have the Siona mark, which is kind of a genetic marker now that implies that they can, you know, they can not be seen by prescience. So there's something weird going on with Duncan, genetically. And Belanda, of course, wants to kill Duncan because he's too dangerous and he might be a Kwisatz Haderach. I think we skipped over that part earlier. She wants to kill him. she thinks he's much too dangerous.
She's a curmudgeon and angry.
Yeah, yeah, kind of like Shuang Yu. And there's some talk of Mirbella finally becoming a full Bene Gesserit, taking the spice agony, and having to give up on Duncan and, you know, any sort of loving relationship because the Bene Gesserit do not love. And yeah, interesting.
Yeah, and how's that going to work? Because
yeah.
She doesn't seem too keen on it, and Duncan doesn't want it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But there really hasn't been a way to become a Bene Gesserit and still have love. Jessica did it, but then she went back.
It's true.
After Leto was killed.
It's true.
So,
yeah, they're going to have to figure that one out. So, Chapter 9 goes back to Great Honor Montre and... we find out that the rabbi and Rebecca and Lucilla have all been captured. And even though they sold out and gave them Lucilla, they've still been held captive. And Rebecca stands in front of Great Honor Matre. And we find out that she has a subdermal spice dispenser that conceals the blue and blue eyes. Interesting. Thing that there. So she definitely takes spice all the time. It's not, you know, just because she didn't take the spice agony doesn't mean that she doesn't take spice. So that, I think that lends credence to that idea of some sort of sisterhood within the Secret Israel group. And at this point, she's carries the Horde of Lampadas, and it's been months since they've first shared. So that's an interesting time jump there. Literally been months captive. At this point, the rabbi feels Rebecca has been tainted by unclean thoughts, and they assume Lucilla is dead. And the question becomes, is Rebecca now Jewish, or is she Bene Gesserit? And there's a there's some conflict between them now at this time. And
And there will be forevermore.
Yeah, exactly. And he goes from being the teacher to somewhat of the student. And it's really interesting how they deal with that. And
I think that's one of the reasons I didn't like him is, you know, he was so reluctant to, I don't know what the term I want to use, but, you know, Rebecca obviously now has so much more life experience and knowledge than him.
Yeah.
And he's not willing to concede any of that.
No, not at all. He just won't.
And it just bugs me. It's like, but she knows so much more than you now.
Well, this is his take. Memory is not wisdom. You know, wisdom is how memories are arranged and applied. And I think there might be something to be said for that. But I feel like this. It's one of those statements that Herbert is making about the entirety of his work in Dune. And you have all these people with all this memory, not necessarily wise though, not necessarily why is there any, you know, conflict? Why are there any issues if all these people have memory? Time and time again, it just goes to show you that it's, memory is not the same thing as wisdom. Just because you have it all and you possess so much doesn't mean you can make the right moves and make the right actions and do the right thing all the time. It's an interesting point of view. So while I don't always love the rabbi in this, you know, as a character, I feel for him. I think I kind of see it, you know, I see what his point of view, even if I don't agree with it.
Yeah. I guess you're just going to be more sympathetic to the guy than I will be.
I guess so.
I'm just going to continue to be harsh on him. I've tried to get over it.
Yeah. 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 So, Rebecca gets, you know, gives some, is questioned about what happened with Miles Teg, the Bene Gesserit, you know, as much as she can be. And, she is, eventually, you know, freed from the automatres. But, you know, we find out that, you know, she was married to a truthsayer, and she describes the ability, and the automatres killed him during the time in captivity as well. So there's some loss there as well. It's an interesting, it's kind of an interesting chapter, but it kind of moves by pretty quickly. Next we get chapter 10, Duncan, Idaho. Kind of the first real chapter with Duncan as the point of view, and as he is exploring the no-ship and looking at the calm eyes. He's a young man now. We caught up with him as a boy in Heretics, and he turned into a man in that book, and now he's a full-grown man. He's had three children so far, with a fourth one on the way, and he's been, you know, like we said, training men in his own version of sexual bonding, and you know, the question is, he a latent Kwisatz Haderach? We learn a little bit more about Mentat thinking, the great synthesis, a mind open to anything. And, you know, Bene Gesserit don't make good Mentats, he thinks. Too much attachment to the sisters, to the self, and to memory. And here's where we start hearing about something odd going on. Every time Duncan goes to the great hold in the nose ship, which still smells like spice from when the worm is in there, he sees something he describes as a shimmering net in his mind's eye. And there, beyond the net, he sees ordinary man and woman who are working on a flower garden, and they always notice him and completely surprised that he can see him. So there's a power going on here. There's something that he's seeing through. It's not prescience, because he's not seeing the future. He's seeing someone else. He's seeing a projection of something. And I don't know. It's very, very mysterious. And it starts being set up here. What's going on? And he can't tell anybody about this, because if he tells anybody, the Bene Gesserit will know. And then all of a sudden, he's a Kwisatz Haderach, and then they'll have to kill him, right? So I don't know. What are your first impressions of this entire scene where he reveals this this phenomenon going on, I guess you'd say?
It is. I think I feel like it has to be some form of prescience, obviously. Mm. But it was always, the whole thing was so weird to me, you know, just an elderly couple working in a garden talking away. It's like such an odd choice for villains.
Yeah. Are they villains? They're just searching, you know, they're searching for something. We don't even know what their motives are, but they're strange and they're very powerful because they don't expect him to see them, but they're clearly searching for him using this net.
Yeah, and they can obviously, we find out that they can see back, not just him, but what's going on around him.
Yeah, yeah, they're watching everything. They can see everything. So it's kind of interesting there. Yeah. I read there's a very interesting article that, you know, we'll get to it later, but a while ago, it's funny, when you look at Dune on the internet, it has the ability to last decades, a lot of articles that are out there about Dune, because it was just such a stagnant franchise for so long, you know, with the exception of the new books, but there wasn't a lot else going on in Dune. So there's so many things that were written very much just lasted, you know, over internet 1.0 and 2.0 and into the modern age of internet and websites. Anyways, there are, there's a very interesting article that was produced a while back about, these two characters, who we find out are Daniel and Marty. And there's some interesting, theories on, you know, the actual meaning of the last chapter and who these people are and what they're actually doing, what their abilities could actually be. And we'll get into that later, because it's very, very interesting what the net could actually be. Anyways, let's move on from here. We find out Morella is pregnant again. Shiana wants to visit Duncan and discuss the Tyrant. It's a lot happens in this. The cult of Shiana has spread. She's now being worshipped across the universe. And Duncan is now taken as Odraid's mentat, above Belanda, who is also a mentat. So that's very interesting.
Yeah, and we'll find out eventually that, you know, she's okay with this choice.
Yeah, true.
He's a better mentat.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
And I think, yeah, he's not too shabby.
Yeah. Chapter 11, Cytale is back, and we have a chapter from his point of view. He's in the no-ship prison, still religiously devout. He has some very interesting lines there. God created me to deceive Pwynda. And we find out that he has a null entropy tube underneath his skin. All the Tilaxu masters do, containing everyone.
game changer.
Yeah, it really is a game changer, because it's like, yeah, I, you know, we have been, anyone notable in the history of humanity, the Tilaxu have been scraping their cells and hiding them and putting them in the null entropy tubes underneath the master's skin.
Yeah.
So
Paul
Chaney,
Jessica,
you know, Leto the second, is Ghani there too? Did they get Ghani?
Yeah, they did.
They got Ghanima. They have everybody, and it's just kind of biding their time there, and no one knows about this yet. So I mean, we're not even talking about, you know, Thufir Hawat and, you know, all the other, Gurney Halleck. I mean, they're all there. They've been doing this the entire time. Yeah. It's funny, like, so it's just this revelation that they can be brought forward into this new age, which is so weird to me. What a weird turn for this story to think about that sort of stuff.
Yeah, like that. Obviously, you bring them back, and it's just amazing that they haven't.
Yeah, they haven't yet. They've been waiting. Yeah,
it shows they're a little longer term planning than you thought that they had.
Yeah, exactly. And why would they ever want to bring them back? I mean, what's the purpose to bring them back? Maybe they didn't even have one yet. You know, or
maybe they were just hedging their bets. You know, grab the samples.
I mean, hell, they could have brought them back.
They might come in.
Yeah.
Yeah, they might come in handy 5,000 years from now. Grab the samples.
They could have brought back Paul five times since then. Who knows, right? There could have been gold as they hid. Who knows? In conversations between Cytale and O'Draid, he discusses that he wants his own servants to feel comfortable. He wants his own face dancers.
Not going to happen.
No, not at all. I get to shut down real quickly. And, you know, you get this internal monologue from Cytale as he talks to O'Draid. Keep continuing to believe the Gola is yours, is what he says. So we're led to believe that, you know, there is something secret going on, and the Gola, Duncan, has been bred for even more nefarious purposes than we ever thought. And Cytale has some sort of key there. And he's going to try and get close to Duncan and use the whistling language to control him and escape.
Yeah, because he's realizing now, you know, he figures out that O'Draid is using Duncan as her mentat. So he has access to all the ship's information, all the ship's data.
That's true.
You know, he's a mentat. They're not going to
need data.
Bottle him up. Yeah, so he's going to have access to data. So he's like, ooh. Yeah. Sweet. So there's a mintat with a bunch of data that I can control.
That's true. Okay, so now here we go. We're with Lucilla, who's been brought before a great honored Matre, and we have a couple of great chapters here with Lucilla and great honored Matre having conversations. We found out the honored Matres are immune to voice and kill on instinct whenever it's used. They don't even think about it. Their body just reacts whenever they hear a voice and just kills. We see the Futar is always present here, and Lucilla starts to wonder about Futars and the relationship between the Honor Matres and Futars. And
yeah, this is where we start to get that, you know, hey, weren't these bred to kill the Honored Matres? Mm-hmm. Why are they just hanging out here?
Yeah, exactly.
And especially like she talks about how they hunt him for pleasure now.
Yeah, exactly. And she's not assessing her her position here and the Automatres themselves, getting inside look on their lifestyle and their defenses and strategy. So, and at the same time, you just get this entire play between Lucilla's thoughts and the horde of Lompidus just screaming at her to survive and to endure so they can endure. And it's really kind of maddening and insane.
And again, how is she sane?
Yeah.
Carrying all that in her head.
I feel like in the millennia since Alia, they've probably studied and refined this ability a little bit more. Yeah. Perhaps. But she figures out that Onomatra defenses are impressive visually, but very crude and primitive by design. Because they're not Onomatras don't think really about defense. They think about only attack only. So they are conquerable. It's possible to beat them if you get a chance to attack, which you typically don't. And that's really the problem with the Onomatras and why the Bene Gesserit can't fight them, because they never got a chance to. So we learned that the Automatres want the Bene Gesserit science and that, you know, their wisdom. And there's a discussion between Lucilla and Gordon Matres about, science being truth and bureaucracy being control and obfuscation. And, they realize that Lucilla comes to realize that the Automatres didn't really necessarily grow out of or evolve from the Bene Gesserit. They actually were from a bureaucratic society. they're the ultimate bureaucrats, and they started to abuse that power and become corrupted and become, you know, the prime example of bureaucrats and total who just fascist to the umpteenth degree. Really, really interesting, right?
Sorry, had a big old drink of water there.
Oh, look at you. Every time I cut to you, you're drinking water.
Yeah, kind of stay hydrated. No, I don't have a still suit. I'm still working on a functioning still suit. I don't have one yet.
Don't be so water fat. So yeah, here we are with this discussion about bureaucracy and the onomatres, and also another interesting discussion. I feel like with Herbert kind of laying out his ideas for, you know, utopia and what the correct government might be, right?
Yeah, but then, you know, their idea of a utopia is essentially that we're in charge. We're going to, you know, not everybody working together. The common idea of a utopia.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, so things start moving quickly here. You'll notice the chapter has Dune moves quickly. There are interesting points in every chapter, but they start to move a lot quicker. And we actually, you know, 50 chapters more or less in the book, and they start to rip through pretty well. In this chapter, Odraid eats with acolytes, something she does commonly, just to kind of get the good lay of the land and understand a little bit more about.
I think it amuses her too.
Yeah, she kind of digs it, right? I think so.
The nervousness of the acolytes.
Yeah, she gets a kick out of it.
I think so.
Yeah, and we find out Odraid is she kind of likes food too. She enjoys food. It's not just kind of a functional thing. She enjoys the pleasure of eating good food. She has we find out later she has a personal chef, and they have this whole rigmarole they have to do to get, you know, a really nice oyster stew. And that's kind of a weird thing we'll get to.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. We have a whole bunch of information kind of thrown at us from all sides here. That Odraid's not well liked, but she carries Tyraza primary. Mirabella.
Yeah, something we talk about.
Yep. Mirabella is ready for the agony at this point. Odraid,
which is surprising because I thought it took longer to train him.
Well, months have passed. You have to remember,
and yeah, years. Somebody that was a
This is like eight years in change.
They're not,
now.
They're not Jedi, I guess.
Yeah, it's not like Dagobah where it takes 5 seconds, but this has been it's been 8 years since Mirabella has been taken by the Bene Gesserit, and then months have passed since the outset of the novel. So there's a lot here to unpack there. So, yeah. This is also the chapter we meet Stragi, who becomes an important figure in Odraid's outfit. And she's going to take up a tour of the planet and visit Shiana unexpectedly and kind of see how the ecology of Chapter House is changing and get a good look at it, even while, you know, war rages on. The chapter ends in a very cryptic way, very much like Herbert likes to do. And she says she's committed herself and the entire sisterhood. Her plan is in motion. Wonder what that means. Wonder the tar, how that is.
Well, it's like the tar with it.
What's that?
I really feel like that's a Tyraza type thing too.
Yeah.
You know, this is the plan.
But, set in you motion. Know,
they were good friends, so I guess they kind of learned from each other.
Dar and Tar, of course.
But then we also find out that Duncan is going to be the key to awaken Teg's memories.
That's true. Makes sense. That's a bit of irony there, seeing as Teg will, you know, awoken his memories. So there's plenty to think about there too as well. All right. Chapter 14, Mirabella and her first point of view chapter here. It goes by pretty quickly. It's not a ton here. She's training in the Bene Gesserit. It's a lot of comparison between the Onomatre way of thinking and training and the Bene Gesserit way of thinking and training. mostly a commentary on the failures of conventional education and bureaucracy. And she's decided she definitely wants to become a Bene Gesserit, or at least like them. And she's pushed herself beyond.
Yeah, she's very unsure of herself.
Yeah. Yeah, she's she took the oath of a Bene Gesserit, but she hasn't actually like really felt like one of them yet. And now she really wants to. She pushes herself too far. She collapses, has a fever. And, you know, it's come to find she's pushed herself beyond her limits. And she has to come to realize a little bit of, you know, the differences between, you know, working herself to death and then working herself to her limits. And, you know, you just get a little bit more about her inner conflicts, about wanting to become a Bene Gesserit and giving up her old way of life, and how she is a much different person than the person we met in Heretics of Dune at this point.
Her old way of life and Duncan again.
Yeah. Yeah. Duncan becomes central to this.
Is she going
to
be able to do that?
That conflict. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Chapter 15, Odraid's point of view, but Tam and Blonde are there. And there's a very interesting conversation on with Tam and Blonde speculating on Infinity. Specifically when they talk about the scattering, like what could be going on out there? And the only answer is really Infinity and anything. Anything could be potentially going on out in the universe. And then they start talking about Holtzman and Holtzman technology, fold space, and the potential bubble universes or alternate realities being created every time the Holtzman fold space generator is used. That's kind of weird, right?
It was something he didn't explore more of, which I was kind of surprised, because it's one of those, it's interesting, but he never really went back to it.
Or was he planning to? Because we haven't even heard the word Holtzman. God, was it mentioning God Emperor, maybe? It might have been mentioning God Emperor before that. I don't think it was mentioned since the original book, when they explained how the guild letters, you know, folded space themselves. And
well, I thought the Holtzman effects was also the shield.
Yep, the shield and
They folded space.
Yeah, the shield and the fold space technology are connected. So there's something going on there. I guess I'll come on and say it. The article that we'll discuss later on, when we think about the older couple that farms, discusses the potential of a reworked version of the Holtzman effect, and that Net could be using that, a hybrid of a shield and fold space technology to try and find Duncan. And there might be something using the Holtzman device going on there. And that's kind of the speculation. And, you know, bringing up in this section, along with the idea of creating bubble universes and potentialities and alternate realities out there, it all just kind of raises a lot of open questions on, you know, what could have been planned for Dune 7, and where is the story really going when it talks about, you know, prescience and, you know, actually moving through that at this point. Pretty cool stuff.
Yeah, I've never actually considered that. That is interesting, and I could almost see it. I don't know.
Yeah, well, one of those,
again, it's so frustrating because we'll never really know. It's a great take, though.
Yeah, definitely. We'll get into it later on. Then we think about we get back to Odraid, and how she thinks about you know, comfortability and familiarity all around Chapterhouse, and thinking that it's pretty bad for the Sisterhood at this point to be comfortable and static. I mean, after all, that's what the God Emperor hated. He hated static things and bureaucracy and no adventure and nothing being different. And she's decided the Sisterhood needs to wake up from complacency and be ultimately adaptable to anything again. And, you know, they wonder about the, you know, what's that?
This is kind of what we were talking about with, you know, taking Tam out and putting Shiana in.
Yeah, Yeah, it's explained more now. You know, her counselors are old. She's thinking about the future of the sisterhood, not just the present. And, you know, will they be scattered into hiding? Or, what will they become? You know, and I love the idea that she needs an inventor and not a mentat at this point. So she decides to incite more violence in the Otter Matres, not less. Make their rampage, you know, amp it up even more so they can hopefully have them slip up and destroy themselves. Bait the bull even more, she says. At this point, Miles Teg is 10 years old and will be sent to Duncan so he can be woken up and have his memories restored. So at this point, you know, Miles Teg was 8 years old. If you think of 8 years have passed since Chapterhouse. So now he's 10. So 2 years have passed in Chapterhouse between chapter 1 and chapter 15. So that's quite a bit. Quite a bit of time has gone on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially like as casually as it did.
Yeah. Yeah. Very, very interesting. Yeah.
It just kind of moves along and all of a sudden you're like, wait, it's been 2 years?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 2 years have passed. Yeah. You know, as we catch up with people, months are passing here. And people are in captivity. You know, Lucilla's been in captivity with the Otter Matres for a while. If you start thinking about that. Chapter 16 is very short. It's Cytail. He's whistling, letting people get comfortable with him doing so. Hopefully trying to, you know, start a big deception here. He plans to make the Bene Gesserit pay and starts formulating a plan. We don't know what that plan is, but we'll find out later. Chapter 17 is about Odraid trying to think like an Otter Matre. At the same time, risk losing her humanity in doing so. And she starts thinking about what wouldn't the Bene Gesserit do to preserve the sisterhood? It's not like they wouldn't block the Golden Path. They didn't do that. And she realizes the survival of humankind always took precedence over the survival of Bene Gesserit. She starts thinking back about Leto and what actions was he trying to manipulate the Bene Gesserit into. And into these musings, we meet a new character, Dortujla, a banished sister from a punishment planet. I love that. They have a whole planet just for punishments for the Bene Gesserit. Pretty cool.
Yeah, it's almost like the old Emperor.
Yeah, definitely. She ran into a band of Futars in her travels and learned something. And she learned that Futars wish to ally themselves with the Bene Gesserit against the Otter Matres. And where is she from? Where is this punishment planet? Boozle. Boozle, which we heard from before, Great Otter Matre being wary of it. Boozle, which is rich in valuable Sue stones. The Otter Matre love this planet. They want the gems. They have amphibian servants to harvest Sue stones, which are valuable to them. So there's another, you know, area of genetic engineering going on out in the scattering. So we have amphibian servants and we have cat people and who knows what else is out there. Pretty cool.
Yeah, they did some dark stuff out there in the scattering.
Yeah, they did.
All kinds of new punishment. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the old Empire, they weren't making weapons to destroy planets in one shot.
No, not at all. Wild.
They didn't have T-probe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The T-probe is like a normal thing now, a way of life. In the past couple of years, the Bene Gesserit have had to learn how to defend against it. We found out Dortujla was kind of a rebel. She used to go back into other memory to perfect skills and hobbies, which is kind of like something that's not allowed because you risk losing yourself in there, of course. But she would go back and be like, yeah, I kind of want to learn how to play the piano, so I'll channel Mozart and Florence and the Machine and try and figure that out. Kind of cool. I think it's a cool...
It'd be a hard thing to resist, you know?
Yeah, I like
you
that.
You know... I don't know how to play the guitar, but you know who does? My great-great-great-great-great-grandmother.
Hendrix. Let's go. You know, it's stuff like that. That'd be kind of cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, with Dortuzla kind of coming to the doorstep of Odraid here, she realizes they start to formulate a plan where Dortuzla will be bait and they will seek a parley on Boozel, or is it Junction? I'm sorry. They'll go to Junction and they'll start to say, you know, the Banjos don't want to surrender, but really this is going to be a trap. They're going to start using the Futars within that trap. Okay. Chapter 18. We have Lucilla. This is actually day 17 of captivity by the Onomatres. Lucilla starts to talk
So we might have a little bit of time jumping back and forth.
A little bit. Lucilla starts talking to the Futars about handlers. Would the Futar accept Lucilla as a handler? You know, she commands the Futar to kill Great Onomatre, but the Futar says she's poison. Is that true? Or do they require a kill command from a handler? Who knows?
And it's so weird because, again, we, you know, bred to kill, but then what's going on with them? Why don't they kill? Why are they subservient? Why are they scared to kill them now?
Have the Onomatres tricked them into thinking they're poison, or are they actually poison? Because of the orange, whatever that drug is that, you know, makes their eyes go orange. Who knows?
Maybe that's how it all started.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Very interesting conversations here between Lucilla and Great Onomatre, who Lucilla calls Great Onomatre Dama as well, just to piss her off. I love that.
Well, yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was making fun of her chin before.
Yeah. That chin is a weak spot in her emotional armor as well, because it's definitely makes her look weak and she doesn't like it. So here's a great dissertation essentially by Herbert using Lucilla and Great Onomatre on law, politics, natural right and power. The Onomatre see themselves as rebels, and at the same time, the Bene Gesserit think that there's a morality above any law. Very interesting.
And this is where the famous line, power attracts the corruptible.
Yeah.
Because it's one of those famous quotes from Frank Herbert, and it's always been one of my favorites of his.
It's true. And, then we start talking about laws and how laws have no human understanding. You know, laws are, it comes up later. Laws, what are they? They protect the present and, I forget what it was, but laws are a preservation of the past. Oh yeah. Laws enforce the future. Regulations enforce the past. Very, very interesting. And that's some Bene Gesserit wisdom for you. And then we start talking about the flaws of bureaucracy and how democracy is dangerous and demagogue prone. Really interesting. I mean, when we started talking about this, it's almost like Frank Herbert was pressing it himself and thinking about the demagogues that we have today in power, like Trump. It's very, very interesting to apply Herbert's reasoning on bureaucracy and democracy and look at our own politics and say, wow, yeah, you kind of nailed it.
Yeah, this is Frank Herbert really going back to his political speech writing days, which he, in Dune, he hasn't really expounded on politics that much to this degree.
Not since God Emperor.
And this is a great chapter.
Yeah, it really is. It's a fantastic chapter.
It seems very relevant today. I will say that. I thought the whole time I was reading, I was like, man, this seems so relevant today.
It feels more relevant in today's America than it does in his, where he thinks about democracy being demagogue prone. I mean, he saw, you know, maybe he was thinking of Nixon at that time. Maybe he was thinking what he's seen, not what could be, you know, coming forward in America, but really, really interesting stuff there. So it's an interesting conversation. You know, they're having this conversation on politics and laws and regulations and bureaucracy. What they're really trying to do is learn about one another by the answers that are given and what the subconscious motives behind those answers are. So they're really, you know, 2 and 3 levels deep of reading each other. Finally, the Futar finally turn. What's that?
I was going to say, usually the Bene Gesserit win those kind of battles, though. You know, trying to read into answers. Yeah, they're generally a little better about that.
Yeah, usually they win.
They're much more intuitive.
Usually.
They're much more intuitive.
Yeah. But some things turn the tide here. Things don't all go in Lucilla's direction. The Futar turns on the Grenada Matre emotionally. If not attacking her, he won't obey her now. And she's like, look what you did. You ruined him. Now I have to kill him. Yeah. And Lucilla just kind of makes a couple of missteps very quickly here that just enrage the Great Grenada Matre. She admits that self-serving groups can't act enlightened. And that just sets off Dama too much. And she says that Lucilla was almost invited into the Honor Matre order. And the Futar refuses to eat her. So, you know, all bets are off now. All of a sudden, Dama, you know, kills Lucilla and the horde screams. The chapter just literally just ends. It just ends. Like,
yeah,
it's like middle of conversation. Grenada Matre kicks Lucilla dead. The horde of Lampada screams.
Yep.
Done. Yeah.
And you almost think that Lucilla is going to get out of there. You know, at some point you're like, you know, we've gone back to her 2 chapters now. You're like, maybe she somehow escapes from this.
Yeah, no, that's it. That's it, you know, just
fooled
like
you.
Just
she's
like
gone.
The chapter ends just like an abrupt death would end. It just like it's in the middle of conversation. She's really trying to weave her imposter her way out of it, and all of a sudden, you know, Grenada Matre has had it. Kicks her in the head, dead, and like abrupt ending. And that's that. And Lucilla failed. The horde of Lampadas is gone. Thank goodness she passed on to Rebecca. And Rebecca is now our only hope to finally have that horde be salvaged. So the stakes have been raised. Great chapter. It's one of the best chapters in all of Dune.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The whole I love that whole conversation.
Yeah.
I went back to it twice this time around.
Yeah, I love how it ends too. Just everything about it, the pacing, it really is just like a microcosm of a chapter within the book. It's really one of the highlights of the entire book, 100%. Chapter 19, I'm imagining some time has passed. We find Audre pacing. She's very stressed out. They have moved into extremis progressiva, the great sharing with one another in the event of annihilation. Pretty much everyone's sharing memories with everyone, so everyone's kind of backed up. You know, I think of this as like backup and disaster recovery at this point. You know, to use a modern term.
Redundancy and
Exactly. There's the question Belanda raises about the sandworm population, restoring the tyrant's influence. Odraid feels the population numbers indicate that the influence has ended, so there's no way to restore that. Very, very interesting. Odraid's inaction, so to speak, has been creating worry at this time. Many groups inside the Bene Gesserit have been thinking of replacing her. The proctors, the Bene Gesserit proctors are going to take a vote, and that happened, and they end up supporting Odraid by literally just one vote. She keeps her position as Reverend Mother, or Reverend Mother Superior by just one vote, by, you know, skin of her teeth.
And I love how, you know, she'd said hi to an acolyte in the hallway and they're chastising him for it. And then she's like, Just so I know how that acolyte vote is voted in your favor.
And they're like, all right, I'll take
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's just kind of like, yeah, tell me what to do.
Yeah, exactly.
Make fun of the way I do things.
Yeah.
It was like a little thumb in her finger at him.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Thumb in her nose at him, I should say. Thumb in her finger, I don't know what.
Yeah. So, Audrey goes back to Brismali's report. Why? Just a lot of questions on why the Animatres are doing what they're doing. Why are they embedded on Gamu so strong? Why are they on Junction? There must be a way to trap and negotiate with the Animatre, or even try and ally with them. Who knows? And the idea, who knows? Who knows why they're doing all these things? Is the Spider Queen even sane by Bene Gesserit's standards? Is a really interesting idea. This comes right after, she's just killed Lucilla as well. I mean, just out of nowhere, almost, in the middle of conversation, and then she kills on sight. So interesting. And then at that point, we have another big question by Herbert. Did the Animatres contemplate being alone in a universe of other sentient life? More than likely, it didn't even cross their minds. This is the first mention in the entire Dune series, 6 books, even discussing aliens, even discussing the potential for alien life. Never once has anything been mentioned that of other sentient species.
I remember reading through the first time through the series and kept wondering if at some point he would introduce something, and he never did.
Never did. But was he planning
on
it?
And I'm okay with it.
Was he planning on it?
I don't think, obviously I don't know, but I don't think he would have. I think Dune had gone this far without sentient light or another sentient race.
Yeah.
And I just don't know what adding them to at this point does. Now, I do think it's interesting, like the Honored Mantre, what's your end goal here? If you enslave all humanity, then what do you have?
Yeah, you have nothing. You end up...
You have a bunch of people that will do whatever you say, but then you guys are just killing each other because you have the rule of two, as we made the joke earlier.
Yeah, you've essentially scoured...
It's like they don't really have an end game.
It's scorched earth. It's 100%. It's a scorched earth rule. And then you just, you're just weakening and destroying the entire human race.
And then your organization will start to cannibalize itself.
That's what they don't see.
It's completely, completely unsustainable.
Yeah.
Idiots.
Yeah. Okay. Chapter 20 here. Duncan is remembering the old Bashar, and Young Teg is talking with him, and he wants to be woken up. He actually is actively saying, yeah, come on, I want my memories restored. And Duncan starts to prepare him to have those memories restored. And they're doing this while training as well. The body learns before the mind in training, and this whole idea there too. There's a little bit of a discussion about Mirbella and Mirbella switching addictions from the adrenaline drug that the Animatres used to melange. Wow, so it's really late. I'm having trouble pronouncing that. I love this idea that Duncan talks about making a Deesian gesture. A shortened form of a Tradesian, a grand dramatic gesture for righteousness. That's pretty funny. That's how Duncan sees whatever Tradies do. They always make a grand dramatic gesture. Interesting. He wants to diverge from, the Bene Gesserit manual for awakening goals. He feels like there has to be a better way to do this, and he wants to go see Shiana. And he wants to talk with her. What do you think about that? Do you think like the love triangle between Duncan, Shiana, and Mirbella Is something going on there? They seem to be pretty close.
I think they're close, and I think there's an attraction there.
Yeah, like almost like the other path, you know what I mean?
Yeah, which happens all the time, unfortunately. But
yeah,
I, sure. I don't think there's the desire to act on it.
Like, okay, so Duncan is addicted to Mirabella. He can't choose her, even though he does love her. But Shiana, he's not he could choose her. You know, maybe that makes the allure even more interesting. And conversely, you know, Shiana was essentially like betrothed to him. Like they were supposed to kind of be the couple that controls the universe and controls humanity. So there's probably that question lingering in the back of their minds, like what their union would be and what could they do together? Would they actually be as powerful as expected? I'm sure that's all back there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're always kind of wondering what would have happened if we had gone down this path.
Yeah. Okay.
If I hadn't met Mirabella.
Yeah, exactly. Chapter 21, Duncan's in the Great Hold. He sees the net again, and we get a little more detail about this. You see that you see the elderly people behind them. They stare back at him with an intensity. Duncan asks why they look so familiar. They appear as gardeners, and the man holds a ball that emits a whistle that hurts his ears. Really interesting. So it's a device that whistles.
Especially when you know what the Twi'leksu do.
Yeah.
How they control their face dancers.
Exactly. But this one's hurting him. It's not controlling him. It's just hurting. And then he comes to the conclusion they look somewhat like face dancers. But he's not sure if they are. He comes to the conclusion this is something that Twi'leksu did to him. We also find out his body has all the chemistry from all his lives. It's his minds that are different. So that's interesting. So Duncan deduces the two people behind the net are two of the enemy that drove the Onomatris back from the scattering and into the old empire. And if they are face dancers, then they're not the same face dancers as the Twi'leksu have. These are independent and they're ruled by themselves. So they're not servants in any way. This is the summation of Duncan. It's not told to us in this book whether or not he's right or not. But it sure seems to be building up that way. We have the Onomatri talking about the enemy of many faces. And then we have Duncan seeing these people and deducing their face dancers. We're kind of looking at a face dancer enemy on a whole different scale than we've ever seen.
We've already been introduced to face dancers that broke hold of the training.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
So,
yeah. Okay, chapter 22. Yeah, and Heretics of Dune. Yeah, we saw that. So that could have been the beginning. Well, who knows? I'm not sure about that because it seems like maybe that face dancer, you know, let's back up here.
I think that face dancer had gotten himself so much into the persona of High Priest.
Tuic, yeah, back then. So let's dig into this a little bit. So the Automatres are running from face dancers who are free and unique and far more powerful than anything we've ever seen. In Heretics of Dune, there is some talk that the Twi'leksu have met with their counterparts from the scattering as well. And they have gained new knowledge and gained new information, and they feel that they're very powerful and enabled with these new alliances from the scattering, all of which didn't turn out to be true at all because they were undone. In the same stroke, they have new face dancers, which they lose control of very quickly because these face dancers are too good. They think they can control them, but it turns out they just become new people and, it's basically just like a failed face dancer experiment because they're too good at their jobs. Is it possible that the Twi'leksu met these new face dancers, tried to take some of that technology and created that one that became High Priest Tuic in Heretics? Is that kind of matching up to you? Is that what we're looking at here?
I mean, I think that's definitely possible.
Yeah, I feel like it matches up.
I don't think we can definitively say, but I could easily, as far as theories go, that one seems like a pretty good one.
Yeah, totally. Next chapter, things start moving real quickly here. And I feel like the rest of the book starts getting quicker and quicker. Odraid muses on her own spice addiction and how she needs to take it every day. It's the first drug in the history of humanity that actually prolongs life, which is something interesting. You okay over there? What's happening?
Oh, I just moved my chair. My chair is on a wooden floor, so it makes
like
a lot of noise.
It sounds like it's smacking stuff all over the place.
I'm sorry. That's sorry, right. I just stood up and the chair made a bunch of noise.
We'll make an edit. Okay, so the day arrives when Odraid's going to go south and see Shiana. This is it. She's the tour of the planet is starting. Belanda is put in charge, but Tamerlane is going to go with Odraid. At this point, only 16 planets remain in Bene Gesserit control. So at the beginning, they'd attack 16, and now only 16 remain.
I feel like my notes were wrong on that first one.
Perhaps. That's all right. And this is the area where we have Odraid requesting oyster stew, and there's this whole ritual with the chef. It's kind of a fun chapter, and you know, after listening to this, we're all like, why am I reading this? What is Herbert doing here? And we see an Odraid savoring something that is about to go away. Oyster stew is, you know, with the desert creeping more and more into the planet and everything getting warmer, we see her doing something ultimately very human, just savoring a really great meal with ingredients that are not going to be there very soon. And the chapter kind of ends with her kind of coming to the conclusion she's sick of the old Bene Gesserit ways, and it's time to drift on the current and seek something new. I like that, you know, at all. We see Odraid becoming more and more like her sea child persona and being malleable and looking for new options and new ways to counteract the threats. I like that.
I was just thinking the same thing, actually.
Yeah. All right. Chapter 23, we return back to Rebecca and the rabbi. They're now in hiding in a no chamber. The question is posed whether Rebecca is part of Secret Israel still or are part of the Bene Gesserit. And it's clear she is something much more than what she was before. Interesting. Some interesting phrases here. You know, what does a mirror look at? I love that. When Rebecca is discussing, you know, how self-reflection is something, an entirely new dimension of it with other memory. You know, also another great one from her. She's clearly become wise beyond the rabbi's experience, based on the knowledge she now has in her head. You know, our gods must mature because we mature. Very interesting secular idea right there too. Very interesting. Also, another note here, Herbert didn't talk about much, but she has a speaker in her memory, one representative from other memory. And that comes back, that's a trait that goes back to all the way back to Dune Messiah. So again, we have Herbert weaving in these ideas. For Alia,
almost like a guide.
Yeah, for Alia, it was the Baron Harkonnen, remember?
Yeah, that didn't go so well.
No, it didn't go so well for her, but she does have a speaker, not identified and by any name, but one person that is acting as a representative for all of them. I think one of the best lines here, she's talking about prescience and talking about seeing the future. And I love this line here. From the moment the Oracle speaks, your future becomes like your past. Damn. That is
a great line.
It's a great summation of the pitfalls of Paul and Leto, and you know why it's such a terrible thing to be able to see the future so definitively.
Yeah, it's something we discussed, you know, is knowing the future isn't always a great thing. You know, he looked at all those paths and Chaney dying in childbirth was mm-hmm. the best option.
But the idea is that...
And knowing it's God, I mean, yeah, and you know it's going to happen as soon as the Oracle tells you. Yeah. Like you say, like it says, you know, as soon as the Oracle tells you what's going to happen...
The future becomes like your past. It's defined. And there's no escaping it. And how boring and trapping is that? It's trapping. To have a future that's the same as the past. Man, you know, we can move away from our past. We, at least we have a forward momentum. But there's no momentum when your future is just like your past. Crazy stuff. And it kind of ends on such a capricious note. The No Chamber is buried underground. And there's a storm, and the ash above the No Chamber, it's worried that it's going to become like concrete with the water. And she's like, yeah, we'll use our tools and we'll use our hands. We'll figure it out. We're fine. Like, yeah. You know, it almost shows like her aloofness almost shows like how detached she is from everyone else around her at this point. And she is very much like a Bene Gesserit and much less like the Rebecca that everyone knew, you know?
Yeah. And now the rabbi is upset about it.
All right. We're almost at the halfway point here.
I'm going to keep.
What's that?
Keep bashing on that guy.
Yeah.
I'm going to keep bashing on that guy.
Yeah, he's not great. I don't think we really get much more of him. He's kind of run his course. All right. Chapter 24 starts.
No.
There's more with him? Maybe a little bit more.
Yeah, he's in 7. He's in 7 and 8.
Oh, really? It's been a long time since I read 7 and 8, so we'll have to get there. Okay. Chapter 24, we catch up with Duncan. He's in the no-ship. He's coming to the idea that the no-ship is not just a no-ship. It's a Bene Gesserit lab to try and beat the no-ship powers, just like Miles Teg did. And to try and discover more about the Onomatre talents as well. And he starts to muse on how he keeps things secret from Bene Gesserit. Sorry, I just yawned. The techniques he uses. And he starts considering the scattering once again, what chases the Onomatres, did who made the futars, are the the face dancers in the net, are they the makers of the futars? Did they make the face dancers? He's starting to put together a lot of things. He's starting to try to put things together. And he comes to the conclusion that the scattering is not uniform. Some things happen out there that didn't happen in other places. There are not everything is happening at the same time.
And which is to be expected in that situation, to be honest.
Yeah, completely. But where the universe they come from, the old Imperium, very much everything happened at the same rate, at the same pace, and was a very uniform universe.
There's a centralized government.
Right.
You know, there was the Emperor and the Landsrod. Mm-hmm. Then there was the God Emperor. Whereas the scattering, they basically were like, yeah, we're done with all this. We're going to go out on our own. So,
yeah, I mean, it's...
There is going to be a lot of difference in how things evolved in cultures.
Yeah. The scattering isn't one.
Evolved.
It wasn't one place. It's not even a region. The scattering is literally just the rest of the universe, and it's not like it's even like you can say, okay, it's this cloud of galaxies here, or this cloud of area. It could literally be separated by big jumps in space and time. You could have humans on one end of the universe, humans on the other end of the universe, humans anywhere in between. The scattering is just pockets and bubbles of activity, all independent, all going in all different directions. It really is. It's infinity in a lot of ways. So a lot of the rest of this chapter is a lot of musings. His relationship with Marbella, wanting control over their addiction. And then more talk about Mentat mode and the area and the Mentat mode that no Mentat should ever go down, which turns them into human vegetables, but they gain the ultimate logic. It almost seems like a parallel to prescience. You know, that was a very interesting point there, that there is a way a mentat can go too far, and then they gain complete insight into all the data and logic of the universe, but they also are restricted. It sounds just like prescience to me. Parallel development of powers.
Yeah, and then you're stuck constantly trying to work through all this information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, completely. Completely. Audrey starts musing with Audrey's fascination with Van Gogh's work, Thatched Cottages at Cour d'Avoil. Interesting. You should look up this painting. Have you seen it before?
I have not.
It's beautiful. It's a masterpiece. It's Van Gogh. I wouldn't say it's remarkable in any way to the story, though. It's worth taking a look at, because the way that he describes the painting and describes the care in which Van Gogh painted it with, I think it lends some depth into the analysis that's on the page. And very at the end, we have a big revelation here in pure Herbert fashion. We talk about all these sorts of things, all these musings. We go over to Van Gogh, talking about thatched cottages. Then all of a sudden, Duncan identified gaps in his goal of genetics, but his memories are complete. How can that be so? He's a linked network outside of time. That's how we can see the net. So it's the best indication we have that he is a Kwisatz Haderach. He's not just a mentat. He's not just a Gola. He is something much different, because he has complete memory. He tapped into something pretty, pretty substantial. Chapter 25. Odraid is on her tour of the planet, and the climate's changing fast. It's pretty much the big summation. She stops a couple of times. A few villages complain about the weather. They reach the sea. It's much smaller than she remembers. She goes for a swim. Oh, yeah, and four more planets got obliterated. They're down to 12 now. And
yeah, just crazy the damage the Honor of Matres have done.
Yeah, in just a couple of days, more, down to 12. So they're falling fast. The Bene Gesserit are much smaller now. Things are getting real. You know what I mean? Soon enough, they're going to find Chapterhouse.
Yeah, and it's kind of weird that the Bene Gesserit she's almost going to have nostalgia for the planet and what it was and what it's going to be.
Yeah.
Which is kind of out of character for Bene Gesserit, but not so much for her.
Yeah, very much she's retreating from her Bene Gesserit instincts, let's say, and she's trying to think new. She's trying to escape the traditional ways the Bene Gesserit think, and think outside the box. And I think going for the swim is putting her in the right mindset and doing something much more human instead of, you know, logical or traditionally Bene Gesserit. So it's all leading somewhere. It's all, you know, it's all going somewhere with us. It's just these little glimpses. It almost, you know, everyone is looking around and be like, she is insane. She's four more planets are down. We're on a trip here, and she wants to go for a swim.
I think the only thing that could have made this scene better is, I am sea child, as she runs out into the ocean.
Yeah, but it's all going somewhere, and we'll find out a little bit more later. But that's the halfway mark of this book. So let's call it there. And in part two, we're gonna get into it picks up really quick, and this book moves at breakneck speed for quite a while. So that's going to be something to really look forward to as we approach the conclusion of the classic era of the Dune saga. And before we move on into the later books and the prequels and everything else in the extended Dune universe. So let's wrap it up here. All right, guys, thank you so much for listening to the DuneCast. You know where to find us. You can find us on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook, I think, and just about everywhere else you can be found. Email us, dunecast@retrozap.com. I can be found at Joey Wong Kenobi, and Rod is at Bald Headed Rod on Twitter. And, you know, we're on part of the RetroZap Podcast Network. Find us and subscribe there. All right, Rod, any final words, final thoughts?
No, I'm looking forward to covering the rest of this book, and also a little sad that it's the last Frank one.
We'll get there. We'll see you next time, guys.